Hello. Much pleasure to introduce our last speaker of today's session, Professor Yiannis Moschovakis from the UCLA and the University of Athens is going to speak about a survey of the regional origins of development of descriptive set theory. Professor Moschovakis, I say one of the founders of the field? May I say that?
I don't know. Oh,
very well
known. I'm too young for that.
But certainly one of the principal promoters of the field. So please, yes.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Frank. The fact is that this is a historical talk. There won't be any proofs. And the way to follow me is if I give it two definitions that you don't know, just remember the words, right? You won't be able to follow some of the reasoning anyway. It's about a subject which I've spent at least half my life working on, so I'm very fond of it. And it's a good tale, so it's worth doing. Let me give the brief outline here. Well, I guess the parts show it. There are four parts, really. The beginnings, which is the period from 1905 to 1938, at least the way I classify it. And then there are three parts where recursion theory comes in, and large cardinal axioms come in, and then determinacy comes in. And in between, there are various interactions. Is that loud enough? No? Okay, all right. So the beginning is a very, very beautiful classical paper. Read it if you ever get a chance. Lebesgue, 1905. This is a period when there was a crisis in the foundations of mathematics, is what it was called, because the contradictions have been produced on the one hand, and from using the same methods that Cantor had used to prove all these beautiful theorems, they were getting contradictions. And the axiom of choice was at the heart of some of these contradictions, though not all of them. So Lebesgue is an analyst at the time, a very famous man. He created Lebesgue integration just a few years before. And he hasn't quite bought the idea that a function is what we call today an arbitrary correspondence, right? Reach X in A, you get a Y in B. You don't say how. It's just a set. It's a set of ordered pairs. He thought that, and that's sort of a paraphrase of what he says, it may be that not every function can be defined by formula. Because up till then, functions were defined by formula. Some of them were infinite power series or trigonometric series. They're not that easy to define, but they were formulas. So he said, maybe there are functions which are not analytically definable, is the word he used. Well, then we should identify them because they should have very special properties. They should have interesting properties that distinguish them. And that today is, we think of it as the beginning of the definability theory in real space and space. So what he did, he defined the Borel sets. Many of you know what the Borel sets. It's the smallest collection of sets, which is a sigma ring. This is in Rn, right, in n space. Let's pick the smallest collection of space that has all the open balls and is closed under countable unions and countable intersections. Okay, and they're very basic, particularly in the theory of integration. So that's the definition of the Borel sets. And then he said that a function is analytically definable. Now, there are many equivalent definitions, but he chose just like for continuity, the inverse image of an open set has to be open. A function is measurable. Borel measurable, he said, if the inverse of every open interval, these are functions from our n space into the real. The inverse image of every open interval is a Borel set. So that was his definition of analytically definable. Today, when we say he's the founder of definability theory on the real numbers, we understand definability to be much broader. But this was his first proposal for what's analytically definable. So here are the special properties that Borel sets have, as he had predicted, because they are the ones that are definable. And there are properties that you don't have, not every set has this nice property, at least if you assume the axiom of choice. So every Borel set is Lebesgue measurable. This is sort of trivial, comes right from the definition of what sets are Lebesgue measurable. The second one is that this cluster, the collection of Borel sets, is closed under complementation. In fact, the definition that I gave, if there's anybody picky in the audience, is not the definition of the usual definition of a sigma ring. A sigma ring must be closed under countable unions and complements, but it's equivalent when you pick the least one. That's also very easy. Borel did that. Now we come to the non-trivial properties. Property P, I won't refer to it this way because you'll forget it and you won't be to blame for it. Every uncountable Borel set has a non-empty perfect subset. Doesn't matter what perfect subset is if you don't know it. The point is that perfect subsets are equinumerous with all the reals. So the way to think of property P is that if you have a class of sets and they all have property P, and the class has property P, that means that that class satisfies the continuum hypothesis. Every uncountable set in that class is equinumerous with the real numbers. So you don't need to, there are no intermediate sets. I will state the continuum hypothesis more formally later on. And the last thing is the property of Baer. It's a little technical, but it's very interesting. It's every Borel set, if you look at it sitting in a plane, there is an open set, a very simple set, and the difference between them, the symmetric difference, the points that are in one of the sets and not the other, is meager, which is, means topologically very small. It's not important what it means, but it's a very nice property. It's a generalization. It falls from what is known as the Baer category theorem. These theorems were very famous at the time because the questions about the continuum hypothesis were dominating the discussion. For example, this property P, it was thought for a while they might solve the continuum problem by proving that every uncountable set has a perfect subset. Then every uncountable set would be equinumerous with the continuum, and that's it. Now, repeating this phrase, I've heard they thought for a while. I don't know who thought for a while, how long they thought about it, but the counterexample with the axiom of choice is very easy. It's easy with the axiom of choice to get an uncountable set that has no perfect subset. Its complement has no perfect subset, etc. Okay. So these are some of the regular properties. More were to come later on. That paper in 1905 is one of these rare cases of a very classical paper that has a bad error in it, a very bad error. It's an error that had an interesting history later on. So here's the wrong theorem in Lebesgue. If you have a Borel set in the plane, let's say, and you take its projection, I have a drawing here later. The projection onto the line of a Borel set is Borel set, right? And you know how most errors in papers are somewhere in the end where it says it is obvious that. He's trying to prove that the Borel sets, the ring of Borel sets has a lot of beautiful plausible properties. He writes this down. It's not even called a lemma. It's évidemment. He says, sorry for the accent. It's not as good as Samuel's. Now, the error wasn't spotted for 11 years, which makes me think that maybe not everybody was reading Lebesgue 1905 at the time, although now we view it as a very pivotal paper. So, I'm sorry, I'm ahead of myself. The reason he needed this theorem was not just for the closure properties. He got from it a corollary that if you have a Borel equation, and you can always solve it, maybe I'll write this down, while it's good with that crashing on the floor. So if you have a Borel equation, right, so you have that f of x, two variables, is zero, f is a Borel. And if you know that for every x, there exists exactly one y. That's why I want to write on the board, because really nobody knows this. It's unique. Does everybody know that? Which satisfies the equation. That means that this equation defines y as a function of x explicitly. Right? I'm sorry, implicitly. But it's a, so then there exists a Borel g of x, which gives all the solutions, such that f of x and g of x is 0 over x. This is what you want to prove. A special case of that is that every one-to-one Borel function has a Borel inverse. It's very important to close the property. So that's a corollary, and he got his trivial proof of that by using this wrong theorem. Now, the error is quoted in 1917 by Suslin, who's at the time 23, and he studied in Moscow, and he's been asked by Luzin, his very famous professor, to read this classic paper, and he finds this hole, right? And it's a terrible. Well, he gets a counterexample. It's very easy to get a Borel set whose projection is not Borel, as long as there are sets that are not Borel anyway. It's not very easy to get that. What's very easy is to get the lemma that Lebesgue used to prove that. All right, so he defines these sets that are projections of Borel sets, but are not Borel. He calls them analytic. And then he proved a whole lot of theorems about analytic sets, including the corollary above. So that's true. The result that Lebesgue wanted is true. It's just that he used the lemma, which was ridiculous. And then Suslin went on and proved what is probably, I think, the first central result of descriptive set theory. A set is Borel if both it and its complements are analytic. Analytic, remember, means it's the projection of a Borel set. So if you have a set, you have a set that I can say very much simpler. I'll say one more thing about this if I can. And then he proved that every uncountable analytic set is a non-empty perfect subset. Now, I forgot one of my jokes in the previous paper. I mentioned in the previous page, I mentioned that every uncountable Borel set has a perfect subset. That was proved by Alexandrov and Hausdorff independently in 1916. It was a big open problem. Their proofs are very difficult, and I never understood them. Well, my joke was I was going to say that, and say, why are you telling us now if you don't know the proof? The point is that Suslin's proof is very beautiful, okay, and much easier. And it implies that all the other results. Okay, now I wanted to say one more thing here. Oh, yes, to see the analysis at the time, the philosophy at the time. They didn't like definitions by transfinite recursion. If you look at the definition of Borel sets, and you try to understand it, take a set theory course to take the least thing. How do you start? Just iterate the operation. Take countable units, take countable intersections, take countable units, starting with the open sets. And by the time you've gone through the countable ordinals, you've got all the Borel sets. You've got something closed on the countable unit and intersection. That now we think of as a constructive operation. They didn't at the time. So Suslin's paper is called A Definition of the Borel Sets Which Does Not Use Countable Ordinals. Today, we would definitely say a definition of the sets which are both projections and co-projections of Borel sets without using the projection operation, right? Because the projection operation is complicated. You quantify over the whole continuum beginning. Anyway, that's where we are in about 1919. Nothing much happens between that time, 1917 and 1925. I mean, there are small results. And then Luzin and Sierpinski independently, they're collaborators, but they're far away at the time. Sierpinski is in Poland, and this is after the First World War. The difficulties of international communication, as it was put at the time, very gently. So they define this, the projective sets, which very, before I draw the hierarchy as they come out, is the smallest class of sets, which you start with the Borel sets, then you allow projection and complementation. Projection and complementation. And they prove, and this, you get what we call the projective sets, and they fall into a hierarchy that looks like this. So here, the notation comes later, and I'll say something about the notation. It's pretty awful. But these are the analytic sets. If you look at the definition there, these classes are defined by induction on N, sigma 1-1 are the analytic sets. So these are projections of Borel sets. These are their complements. So the pi each time is the complement, right? So sigma 1-2 are the projections of pi 1-1, etc. And then these delta classes are the classes which are the self-dual classes, as they're called, because they're closed by the negation. They said it's delta 1-1. If it's both analytic and co-analytic. If it's analytic and its complement is also analytic, by Suslin's theory, that's Borel, right? And this is a hierarchy. you keep getting your things, and it gives you a measure of difficulty, of a measure of complexity, we might say today, for these very complicated Borel sets. That's mostly all Luzin and Sierpinski proved about this. Sierpinski also had a very beautiful result about sigma 1-2 set, but I'm not going into this kind of detail now. So I want to, So this is a structural property, if you want to, but where are the nice properties of sets, right? I mean, there are no, the regularity that Lebesgue was suspecting, even though these definitions are a little complicated, you would expect that these sets would have special properties. They didn't find that many. Think of Sierpinski that I referred to was one of them. But they did find one much later, 1938. So it goes from 1925 to 1938. So I want to explain the notion of uniformization, what the uniformization of a set is. And then I'll tell the result here. So you have a set P in the plane. And if you come down like this, its projection is that piece on the line, right? A subset P star is a uniformization or uniformizes P if every vertical line here that intersects X is non-empty. So if you look at one of these lines here above X, if it intersects P, it has exactly one point in P star. So it's the function. You can use the same definition instead of using uniformization, you talk about a selection function. There is always one by the axiom of choice, right? But to get a definable one is very difficult, and there are many fields whose basic result is a uniformization theorem, where the uniformization not only does that, but has maybe structure. So this is the best theorem about classical, from classical descriptive set theory. It was proved by Kondo in 1938. I'll say something about the history. Every set in the second level of the projective hierarchy, sigma 1-2 set in the plane, can be uniformized by another sigma 1-2 set. Okay? A lot of work has gone into that. It's a basic idea of Novikov, the great Novikov, one of the greatest mathematicians of his time, but Kondo got it first. So we have this period from 1905 to 1938, that's 33 years. By then, the crisis in the mathematical foundations has settled down. Cermello-Frankel set theory had been written up completely. Cermello had it in 1908. By 1930-something, the axiom of replacement was formulated. And there's more or less some agreement that that's the axiomatization of mathematics. I should say that during these years, practically every good mathematician in the world worked on the subject of definable sets. Right? I just will not go into that detail. Not only Novikov did, Kuratowski in Poland did. He wrote a book, ultimately, actually, on it. Novikov's wife, Keldysh, I think was her name, was also had some very substantial contribution. So, but the kind of technical theorems that gets you papers, it was not the best work. It was considered in the center of mathematics, and everybody had to pay his regards to it. Now, they didn't go any more than that. They didn't prove any regularity theorem. So the regularity comes up to sigma 1-2, but they couldn't prove that every sigma 1-2 set is Lebesgue measure. They could prove it can be uniformized, right? So you don't need the axiom of choice for sigma 1-2 sets. But regularity, and there's absolutely nothing known about this set. Absolutely nothing at all. So now what I call the interlude in this lecture is there's a reason why nothing could be proved there. Because nothing could be proved in Cermello-Frankel set theory. There are independence results. Well, this comes in two hits, so to speak. One is Gödel, who in 1938 proves, let me write it down. He was interested in the continuum hypothesis. So ZFC now, Cermello-Frankel set theory with the full axiom of choice, is the accepted theory. The continuum hypothesis, I finally wrote it down here. Every uncountable A is equinumerous of reals, is equinumerous with the whole reals. I'm writing it in a form that doesn't use ordinals because Samuel was right. You need action of choice to even write it in terms of ordinal arithmetic, and that's irrelevant. The hypothesis is only if you want to directly define in terms of is the hypothesis formulated directly into the very basic notion of set theory, membership and equinumerosity, right? All right, so Gödel, using a lot of logic in addition to a lot of set theory, creates the so-called constructible universe, defines a special collection of sets, which are all definable using ordinals, right? He proves that that universe of sets satisfies all the axioms of ZFC to begin with, and it satisfies the continuum hypothesis. That means you cannot violate the continuum hypothesis, you cannot disprove it in ZFC. In terms of regularity of sets, he says that that universe is lousy. There are sigma 1-2 sets which are not Lebesgue measurable, do not have a perfect subset, although they're uncountable, and do not have the property of Baer, which you don't remember it if you haven't seen it before, but it doesn't matter. It's a nice property to have, right? I just needed some names. So the constructible universe is very nice from some point of view. Every set is definable from the ordinals in set theoretic terms. The structure is bad. Now, in terms of the structure of the projective hierarchy, it's very regular. You have every sigma, you know, Kondo proved that sigma 1-2 is separable, is uniformizable. Every sigma 1-2 set can be as a sigma 1-2 uniformization. In the constructible universe, starting from k equals 2 going all the way up, they all. So that you couldn't violate it. You could have proved that without the axiom of choice, as far as they knew then. Never mind choice. You could have proved it without using anything new, but you couldn't violate it. And then there was nothing again terribly important happening in set theory until 1963, when Paul Cohen proves the independence of the continuum hypothesis from ZFC. He proved several other things, but that's what he was interested in. He proves you cannot disprove it. I mean, you cannot prove it in ZFC, right? Gödel had shown that you cannot disprove it. He proved so that you cannot prove it. Now, he did three other things that I don't want to mention them because they're technical, but he started an avalanche of work which is going on now. One of the most active areas of set theory is independence and consistency results, which mostly means working in constructibility and forcing. So that made it official. Nothing of any importance about the projective sets above the second level could be established in set theory. Any question you thought of, it was proved consistent and independent. Consistent and independent. It's a sequence of results. I said nothing happened in between there. You know, that's almost true. Partly because another war was on. But in fact, the number of people that worked in set theory from the 30s, starting from Kondo, let's say, until the late 50s, started a little before Cohen, were very, very few. In terms of really important work coming out, they were probably no more than 10. It was Shepherdson in England, and Moschovakis in Poland, and a few other people. But starting with the late 40s, some people start coming in again, but it's very little because they couldn't answer any questions, you see. Okay, so now here comes from the left side, as they say, developments in recursion theory which got into this story sooner or later. Okay, and for a while it looked like I'm giving an entirely different talk. So in 1943, Kleene, who was at Princeton, is an American, he started studying he had developed some of the basic results in computability theory, right? And if you've taken a course in recursion theory, you've seen his name, the normal form theorem and what have you. And then he started studying the first order definable relations in the standard model of arithmetic. You have natural numbers, plus and times, and you ask which relations can be defined. These are the arithmetical relations. I have them defined a little bit differently here, but it doesn't matter. It's the smallest collection of sets that has the recursive relations, and the closure properties are first order closure properties, including the quantifiers. The paper, in fact, was called Recursive Predicates and Number Quantifiers. This 1943 paper. So they fall into a hierarchy that I'm not going to study, a hierarchy again of unsolvability of relations on the natural numbers now, right? And the simplest one is the truth relation. You know how to code, get Gödel numbers of sentences, then you have to do that, and then you pick the set of sentences which are true, right? This cannot be defined in arithmetic. That's one of Gödel's results. This is actually Tashkent's result, but it's the same collection of results there. And he wanted to understand more complicated sets that include this in particular. So he wrote in 1955, at least he published in 1955, three papers that started a whole work in understanding very deep papers, all three of them, which studies the second order definable relations on the natural numbers. So let me remind you what that is. By the second order structure on the natural numbers, usually a second order logic over structure is considered, you add to the language quantifiers over sets, right? You can also add quantifiers over functions if your language is strong enough to be able to represent a function by its, as a graph, or represent a set as a characteristic, as a domain of a function. So here is the structure he worked with. He thinks of it as a first order structure. Here's the natural number. This N there is bare space. It's the set of all infinite sequence of numbers. And you can use them to code sets. Then you have the zero and the one, the plus and the times. And you have one operation application that takes a number and a point in bare space and gives you the value. All right? So it's a two-sorted structure, but that's all right. Structure with two universes, I've studied all the time. So he studied definability in his papers. He studied definability in this structure. So you have quantifiers both over numbers and over sets. So now I'm going to write. So he got a hierarchy, right? Just like with the projective sets. But the space here is the natural numbers, but in order to use these quantifiers over bare space, you have to allow among the variables and points in bare space sequences. So he's looking at the sets definable over this structure, the second order arithmetic, the structure of second order arithmetic, of number and bare space variables. And for these, he proves the following thing. Let's call a set arithmetical if it can be defined using no quantifiers over bare space, and let's call a set σ11 if it can be defined, if it's the projection of an arithmetical set. Now, if you remember anything from the previous few slides, or if you've seen it someplace else, we've already used σ11, right, to call the analytical sets of Rn. Can anybody see the difference between this σ11 and the other σ11? Not really, right? The other σ11 was bold-faced. This σ11 is light-faced. Kleene is not to be blamed for that. I will mention the person who's to blame for that later on. There's a very good reason for his notation, but boy, is it confusing the first time you see it. So he, on the other hand, let's try to remember this σ11 is like the other σ11. That's why they're using it, right? And we'll talk about the connection in a minute. So he defines not only σ11, but also σ12, σ13, π11, just like before, and they go with exactly the same definition. The σ11 is σ11, we go inductively. The π1n is the complements of σ1n, and the σ1n+1 are the projections of π1n. This is exactly like before, and the deltas are in the structures, except the spaces are different, and then he proves this hierarchy. I will put this in a slide or two down together with the classical hierarchy, so we'll be able to see the connection, right? But now, think of it that way. He introduces a notion, a way of comparing the complexity of sets that you get by starting with just the primitives of the structure, recursive sets, really, and adding number and quantifiers and functions of a bare space, and he shows that they fall into this proper hierarchy. There's something you can write using one quantifier that you cannot write using one quantifier of both kinds. That does work, etc. He doesn't have Suslin's theorem, right? Remember, in the other hierarchy, the Borel says proceeding here. He doesn't have that. Well, he has that. Go ahead and prove it. So the analog of the Borel sets is going to be something you call the hyper-arithmetical set. I'm going to give you a definition. Remember what the Borel sets are, Borel subsets in Rn, is the smallest sigma field that contains the open set. The smallest connection, the collection of subsets of n-space that has the open sets and is closed under countable unions and countable intersections. He's going to take the hyper-arithmetical sets to be the smallest effective sigma. So let's define what an effective sigma field is. It has to be coded by numbers. Kleene was the master of coding. He got that from Gödel, to be sure, but he was a master of using. So a coded family of subsets of n, sets of natural numbers, is a pair of two things. The second thing, the S, is going to be the collection of subsets that we have, and pi is going to be the coding. So what is the coding? Well, it's a function defined on some set of numbers, not all of them necessarily, onto the things that it's coding. And of course, as we always think about codes, what we say is that, this is the way I'm going to say it, a set A belongs to S with code I if I is a code and the set assigns, the assigns is pi of I, okay? So that's, and then we call a collection like this, a pair like this, an effective sigma field if it has some properties. Now, let me remind you, if people know some computability theory here, well, there are Turing machines and they compute things, right? And you can code the Turing machines, and then you need a name for the partial function defined by the Turing machine of code E on the natural numbers. So think of them as Turing machines here. That's the best we can do that. So here are the properties of an effective sigma field. First of all, every singleton now, I can't talk about open balls, there's no need. These are natural numbers, right? Every singleton is in the sigma field with a code that I can compute. So here is that. The first of these three auxiliary functions is a total function, and for every number n, c1 of n is a code of the singleton. Second, if you have a Turing computable function, a Turing machine with code E, which is total, it's always defined, and if all its values are codes of members of the sigma field, then C2 of E is a code of the union, and the same for the intersection. This is very sophisticated, and in fact, that's not the way that Kleene defined those. This definition is later done, I think it's due to Schoenfield. Kleene's definition was a hell of a lot worse. Let me tell you, it was very hard to understand this definition. He defines a hierarchy of sets using a good notation system for countable ordinals, and then he takes all the sets that are recursive in this. It's a non-trivial thing. Thank you. But that's equivalent to that, and he proves that there is a smallest one of these things, and these are the hyper-arithmetical sets. Okay? So now we have this picture, that's Kleene's theorem. The sets that are, and then he proved that the hyper-arithmetical sets are the sets which are both pi 1 1 and sigma 1 1. Now here I have the two hierarchies, and I'm running out of time. Let's see, I talk until 50 minutes. Do I have... Yeah, okay. Yeah, I think I can do it. So, these are the two hierarchies. This is the space, n space. These are the Borel sets, and here is the hierarchy of the projective sets that we get by starting with the Borel sets, let's say, and iterating projections. Here are the hyper-arithmetical sets, much more complicated than the Borel sets, but very similar in structure and definition. And here is the corresponding hierarchy, but it's on these spaces. Now, these were called in the beginning the analogies between the classical work and the work of Kleene. Kleene had no idea about Borel sets, had no idea about projective sets. But one of his students, John Harrison, went to Poland for a while to study with Moschovakis. And Moschovakis knew everything. And They saw these analogies despite the notations at the time, which were very different. Then Aristotle invented the system to point out to the analogies, which has been confusing people since then, but it does emphasize the point. And in time and with the work of a lot of people, the two fields join as parts of one field, what we call now effective descriptive set theory. The spaces about which he talks include N space for the reals, include bare space, include the natural numbers, are closed on the Cartesian product. They are technically, they're called recursive polyspaces, but we don't need to go there. Characteristics of the effective descriptive set theory are the codings. Everything is coded. That's the way the proofs are used. And there are a lot of structural results about families of sets and not so many about regularity of sets. Because how many regularities do you find in a set of natural numbers? I mean, you can talk about densities or something like this, but they're all pretty regular. But the structure of sets became very important. So that's the second part of the... Oh, yeah, the other thing that's characteristic is that the effective methods from effective descriptive set theory, from recursive theory, in fact, were used and are still used to get results that don't involve any of the effective notions, classical results. They tend not to be very powerful. Now, the recursion theory won't help you solve problems that are independent of ZFC. So there was a move starting around 56 or 58 when these results became, when people started getting interested in descriptive set theory before, partly because of the recursion theory. So there was an interest to see what you can do about the independence results, and there are two tendencies. One is to say it's a Mellow-Frankel set theory is like ring theory. We will study independence and consistency results in it. We will get models of Chermelo-Frankel set theory with increasing or decreasing ideals or whatever. That's called formalism. The other one is people who thought that maybe there is some truth, some meaning one can realistically speak about sets, and we should look for axioms that are plausible, that go beyond ZFC, and allow us to solve some of this, particularly the continuum hypothesis. The first I was trying were measurable cardinals, but since I'm running out of time and I won't even have time to define what they are, I will split that. It'll be on the slide. It produced some new results with a large cardinal axiom, an axiom saying a very large set exists, and it produced some results but couldn't go very far. And then there was a deus ex machina. I come now to the last part here. In 1967, Blackwell, who was one of the world's most distinguished statisticians in Berkeley, brilliant man, gave a new proof of a basic property of analytic sets, classical property, due to losing, but using an entirely different proof. He used games. And this was so imaginary that many people, several people who saw it, right upon seeing it, realized that that was a new way to attach these problems and, in particular, find new axioms. I will explain, so let me now say something about these games that Blackwell used. I wrote on about games that patient people play because these are infinite games. It's not like chess that it will stop in a while. It can go forever. So there are two player games. There's player one and player two. Sometimes people call them Bob and Alice, but I'm from where we didn't used to do that. So one and two play, one plays first, that's why he's called the first player, and et cetera. And they play natural numbers. They could play on an arbitrary set, but what we need here is they play natural numbers. It's called the perfect information game because every time I need to play, I have seen everything that has happened before, right? There's no secret cards underneath. So they're perfect information, they're infinite, they go on forever, and then what happens when at the end? Well, this is the game that corresponds to a set A, a subset of bare space, a set of sequences. So at the end of time, a sequence has been determined. The first player wins if alpha is in the sequence, the second player wins otherwise. So these games, somebody always wins, right? They're perfect information and they're infinite. They're very hard to try to see who wins unless the games are trivial. Yeah, so this is the winning condition. A set A is determined That's the definition. We think about the set. If the game is determined, meaning if one of the two has a winning strategy. Now, I'm not going to define a winning strategy because I think if you play any game at all, you know what a winning strategy is. You all know the winning strategy for tic-tac-toe, right? 3x3 tic-tac-toe. You know how to play, seeing what the other guy did up to now, so that you will win. As long as it's a game that somebody wins, somebody loses. The other person loses. So, the only things that were known early is in this Gail Stewart paper from 1950 that every open set is determined. And on the other hand, there are games which are not determined. That proof uses the axiom of choice. And nobody has produced a definable game, actually define a specific game and prove that it is not determined without using the axiom of choice. Okay, and that's where 60 years later. On the other hand, if you start going a little more into the Borel sets, how about the sets that are countable unions, countable intersections of open sets, or countable unions, or countable, it starts getting harder and harder, and you poop out at about the third level. It's very hard to prove determinacy of sets. What happened is with these brave people, and I was one of them, they just blindly assume that every projective set is determined. That's the new axiom. That was proposed as a new axiom in 1967, right after Blackwell's paper. Projective determinacy is not known to be inconsistent with GFC, right? I'll say something later in a few minutes about its consistency strength. Is not known to be implemented. And already in 67, when Blackwell came in with his brilliant idea, a lot of things were known about it in Poland. People had been studying games like this from the 20s. But it wasn't known in the West. It was known that using projective determinacy, for example, they had postulated projective determinacy, but that's one of the results they proved. Michelski and Steinhaus, that every set of real numbers is Lebesgue measurable, has a property of pair. If it's uncountable, it has a perfect subset. These are fairly easy results. You take the game, the set, you write a game corresponding to it, you assume that this game is determined, and then we use the winning strategy of whichever player to get the corresponding game. I'm not saying the trivial result, right? It's a good, very strong people. But the results that they don't need, they're technical results. Then it turned out, right after 1967, and in a period from 67 until, I would say, at least the 80s, were a huge number of results about the problems about the projective sets were solved. The constructible universe of Gödel and the projective determinacy hypothesis both prove so many answers, so many questions about projective sets that they're called quite sometimes morally complete. Of course, you can have a complete theory, which is axiomatizable, right, by Gödel's theorem for the projective sets. But any mathematical question that you want to answer, I will put one, and a lot of people were there, and I already know some people that I didn't put there. I'm talking about in the beginning now, a lot of people are working in. I'll write just one result, partly because it's fine, but jokes aside, it's one of the basic results here, which is easy to state in terms of what we have. Every sigma 1 set on the even side can be uniformized like a sigma by set in the same class, just the way it was true for sigma 1, 2 with no hypothesis. And then, and here's the peculiarity, every pi set of odd level can be uniformized by a pi set. The structure is interesting and somewhat peculiar. Right. Now, in the beginning, when people would work in this area, and as I said, I was one of them, there was always this suspicion that the inconsistency may come around tomorrow. There was no chance to prove projective determinacy. There was no chance. There were no proofs. There were no proofs of consistency. And people expected it any minute. And then, in 1975, Tony Martin, Donald A. Martin is his full name, proved this incredible result in ZFC that everybody else had is determined. That's a very difficult proof. The question, of course, has been asked repeatedly because there is this hierarchy of Borel sets that you start with the open sets and you take countable unions and intersections. And they have gone up to level 3 or 4, and that's all. He couldn't do any more and prove determinism. And he does it for all of the Borel sets with a brilliant proof. We were using hypotheses of determinism for sets much more complicated than the Borel sets, but this one seemed to legitimize it made it look a little bit like this every Borel set, which is uncountable, is a perfect subset. It looks like a good regularity property. It's a regularity property, right? It probably extends. And indeed, it was extended in 1988. Martin and Steele used large cardinals to prove PD, and then they used cardinals called wooden cardinals, and then wooden extended the result quite a bit more, which I know of the moment. Now, why would a proof from large cardinals legitimize a subject? It's because somehow people thought there's something better, something more reasonable to add to set theory than determinacy. You see, large cardinals say there's a set which is way up there, right? And I haven't seen it. And of course, there were theorems, the page that I skipped, unfortunately. These have effect on the structure of the continuum. Well, here is the strongest effect that they've had on the structure of the continuum. These wooden cardinals, as far as large cardinals go, are fairly small, actually. And they suffice to prove that every projective set is determined. But I'm not going to go anymore, and it's not only because I don't have time. Starting at about 1990, it was a breakthrough result by Harrington, Keckes, and Lugol about Borel equivalence relations. A lot of the work in this area has gone into applications into classical mathematics. They have non-trivial applications into ergodic theory and also the theory of graphs and a lot of other things that I don't know. But I would say it's fair to say that the best work there is done in applications and not in the foundations of the subject. But the subject still has, of course, every part of logic, set theory, recursion theory, they all are in touch with the foundations. They have an interaction with the foundations. I still think descriptive set theory is one of the very mathematical parts of sort of logic, but with a very small interaction, very large, very important interaction with the foundations. Is that okay now? Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Yiannis. Now we have some
time for questions. It was too fast, too much. There are no questions.
It's more a comment than a question, and it's not about the action of choice. Oh, well, just to do some advertising of one of my personal heroes, during this interlude, we had this Rothberger guy.
This what?
Rothberger. Rothberger. Rothberger, Franz Rothberger.
I'm sorry, I don't know him yet. Yeah. Go ahead.
And he had proved many things about small cardinals, even before Cohen. For instance, he proved that if P is Aleph 1, then T is Aleph 1. The Aleph 1 case of P equals T, Rothberger proved it in the 40s.
Oh, I see. This is the thing that they now were sold by Mariaris and Shellan. Yeah.
So this Rothberger guy has proven many results on small cardinals that we only would make sense if the continuum hypothesis was supposedly false. If not, they were all valid one. So it's an interesting guy.
I'm sorry, I don't know him. It's not my field. This cardinal advice, that's too difficult a subject for me. But among the people that tend to think, take seriously the question, is the continuum hypothesis true or false, right? Not everybody takes it seriously. Some people, including Shalab, think this is nonsense. But it's interesting to see what the feelings about that have been over the years. In the summer of 67, there was an American Mathematical Society summer research institute at UCLA, in fact, And John Harrison, who always likes jokes, took a vote to continue hypothesis. Is it, does it have a truth value? And if you think it's true, is it true or is it false? And it was amazing at that time because my memory now, maybe you mean it's cloaked, but my memory is that there was a majority, not a big majority, that thought it is a meaningful question and that it's probably false. And in any case, that was the orthodoxy that developed in the years after that. People that were using this, very brave people, this huge, large kind of action that could be inconsistent, you know, proved inconsistent any day, or determinants even worse. They were convinced that they had the Holy Grail, and sooner or later, the continuum hypothesis is not expressible in terms of projective sets, right? It's third order number theory. So these methods can't touch it. But I know people, some people I know very well, that have spent an awful lot of time trying to find axioms in third order number theory that might help. But because the continuum hypothesis involves probability, that makes it very difficult. So I didn't know about that. Anything else or we had enough? Okay. Thank you for coming. Thank you.